Please confirm that it's recording.
It's recording, yeah, go ahead.
Okay, good. So, welcome back, everyone. So, moving ahead, we're going to be talking about building heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system, HVAC for short. Okay, so the HVAC system is a significant energy user in building. That's what SEU means. It's a significant energy user in building. So significant portion of a building energy consumption is for heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system, okay? Mostly for commercial buildings. Now, there are statistics here for other countries. Unfortunately, there's no statistics for Nigeria, but it's not different from them. In fact, in Nigeria, cooling is more for commercial buildings. Cooling is as, I think it's similar to what you have in KSA or UK. I know it's over 50, between 50 to 70% for commercial buildings. Okay. So that's why it's very, very important, you know, to pay attention to the cooling system. There's a lot of opportunity to save energy in the cooling system. Okay. Just like we have so much opportunity to save energy in the boiler and steam system, there is so much opportunity to save energy in the HVAC system. We're going to be discussing them in a bit. So what induces the cooling load, okay? So you have the heat influx from envelope. When you hear envelope, it's just talking about the building shell, the roof, the windows, the doors, the walls, and all that. Then you have direct irradiation from the sun through the windows, the glasses, and all of that. Then you have air leakage / ventilation, whether natural or forced, okay, into the house. So if you're trying, normally we try to control the air inside the buildings or inside the house where we stay. If there are leakages, if there are spaces where the outside air can interfere with the inner air, then you begin to lose certain level of control. And when that begins to happen, it's a sign of inefficiency, okay? In as much as you're trying to control the indoor temperature using energy, except you want to do that naturally, then that's fine. But in as much as you're using energy to do that, to achieve that level of control, if there are spaces within the building shell that interferes with the outdoor temperature or outdoor humidity or all of that, then you're losing control, and that's an energy waste. So within the indoor, human beings generate heat. So we have waste heat. If you touch our body temperature, you find out it is hot, okay? So through the body metabolic activities, we generate heat, and this heat is being now absorbed into the environment. So if you're not running your air conditioning system, your air conditioning system is now expelling that heat into the atmosphere outside. Okay, so human beings generate it. So waste heat from other appliances, just as lightings, machines, appliances, data servers, your TV, your light bulbs, your fan, and all of that, they all generate it. And all of this needs to be evacuated for you to be comfortable, or even for your appliances to work optimally. You need to evacuate this heat. And that's why HVAC is very, very important. So here we're trying to define a thermal comfort. Okay, someone might ask, okay, what are the parameters? What are the benchmarks to say that someone has achieved a thermal comfort? There is no straight bullet to it, but there are range. There's a range, actually. So indoor temperatures between 20 and 26 degrees centigrade, depending on activity. Now, activity depends on maybe just a moment. Just want to check if there's somebody waiting. I hope nobody. Okay, good. So depending on the level of your activity, if you're a sports person, it's expected that you're going to have a higher, you're going to require a cooler temperature because your body metabolic activities, your body, this thing is going to generate more heat. So you're going to need a cooler temperature to remain comfortable. But if you have a low body metabolic activities, then you might require a higher temperature to stay comfortable. So it varies, but in most cases between 20 and 26, you should be very comfortable. Then indoor humidity as well also matters, okay? If you leave the temperature constant at 30 degrees centigrade and you turn down the humidity to about 15, you most likely you'll be comfortable. But leave that temperature at 30 degrees centigrade and then raise the humidity to 70, you'll feel very uncomfortable. So humidity has a role to play in your comfort, the comfort of your environment, or rather in your own comfort within your environment. So airspeed also has a role here. This one deals mostly with if you're using a fan to cool your body, okay, the volume of air that passes through your skin and all of that, or through the equipment you want to cool, is also a factor, you know. So airspeed below 0.2 meter per second at 20 degrees centigrade, if possible 0.1 meter per second, is okay, you're going to be fine. Now, this is not thermal, but often neglected. The CO2 level in the space. I remember there was a time we were having a training in an enclosed space. It got to a point where in as much as the ACs we are running, but we needed to open the windows, okay? But not permanently, just for a little while to have that AC. Now, the problem is we have a lot of people within an enclosed space, and we all breathe out CO2. Sometimes, if you don't wash it, the CO2 level might begin to increase, okay? And it can get a certain point where people will begin to feel dizzy. I mean, you lose concentration, and so it affects your entire well-being. So it's very important to look out for the CO2 level, okay? So this is often neglected, but it's very important. So CO2 level below 1,000 ppm, parts per million, it's fine. But once it begins to go beyond 1,000 parts per million, then your the efficiency of your performance as a human being begins to drop. You might begin to feel dizzy. You might begin to, in fact, you begin to perform in an inoptimal way. So it's very, very important that we also monitor the CO2 level. So what can be done? A well-designed building can reduce the heating and cooling load by up to 30%. You remember when I talked about cooling your, trying to control the space, okay? The air within the space where you are using, expanding energy to control that. If you're not using energy to control that, maybe you're doing that naturally. Maybe you open your glass, your windows, and then that is passive cooling. You're not, it's natural. You're not spending energy to do that. You're not, using energy to do that, it is natural. So when you're designing a building, it is always important from onset to look out for those means, those strategies to cool the building naturally so that you don't spend so much energy in cooling the building when it is being occupied, okay? So if you design those buildings very well, there are chances that you can reduce the need for cooling in those buildings by 30%. But if it's completely built, then there is little or nothing much you can do rather than to begin to now cool those buildings mechanically using mechanical means. So these outcomes can be reached by adopting passive design features or construction measures, using light colors for the envelopes, using shading. You can block out sun, you know, heating instead of the sunlight hitting your wall straight. If it hits your wall, it hits the wall, and then through conduction, that heat comes into your house and it heats up your house, and then you will need to use an air conditioning system to expel that heat, and then you're spending a lot of money cooling. So, but if you're able to block out that sun, then it doesn't even get to your wall, it doesn't get into your house, then you can remain cool. So the next one is airtightness. When you're running your air conditioning system, make sure that the environment is airtight. Okay, but again, like I said the other time, watch your CO2 level, especially when you have a lot of people within a space. Then double glaze the window. If you have a double glazed window, double glazed window means that the windows are like two layers. The in between the layers, you have heat resistant materials in between them, okay, just to make sure that it keeps heat. I mean, it doesn't allow heat transfer into your space. it's quite expensive, but for the countries where energy is very expensive and where you have a very high temperature difference, okay, it might be well worth it. So roof insulation, these days I see some people making their roof black. I don't know what's the motive behind that. Because of course, you know, black surfaces absorb heat, right? So I don't know what's the motive. This is just about the aesthetic. It's just about the beauty. Okay, but from the energy perspective side of it, it's not efficient way of design. Okay, your roof, of course, if you have a bright colors on your roof, it reflects some of the heat. It doesn't have to come into your house. So wall insulation. I think there are pictures that I can share in this slide. Okay, so perfect. This is Lagos, Nigeria. If you look at the wall, you see that the building by your right, they had used natural vegetation to block out sunlight from hitting the wall and then transferring the heat into the building. I think the building is also tiled. You know, tiles are very good. They have poor heat conductivity. In other words, they have high resistivity for heat. Okay. Resistivity is opposite of conductivity. So when you look at the other picture by the left, it's a tall building. There are some elements of installations on that building, glasses, and then you have some awnings, you know, some extensions from the glass to provide shadow cast on part of the building so that the sun does not get direct access into the building. It's not quite clear, but if you zoom, you'll be able to see what I mean. Now, this is Austria, okay? But I remember some of the buildings in my school have the same design with what you have in the middle. Yes, some of the buildings in my school have those kind of designs. So the essence of these designs is just to prevent outdoor heat from gaining access into the indoor space. So if you do all of this design and everything, you'll be able to keep the heat out where they should be, and then the indoor should be comfortable, except that you need to expect some of the heat that have been generated indoor. But in this case, no external heat is coming. I mean, it's not like external heat is not going to come in. Obviously, it's going to come in, but in a very minimal quantity. So that's the whole essence of the designs. In that way, you're not going to spend so much energy to expel the heat. It costs a lot to cool. Maybe a lot of people don't know. I've had a lot of people calling me that they loaded their meter and in the next 1 or 2 weeks it's finished and all of that. And I think the first thing I ask them, do you run an AC? They say yes. How often do you run your AC? At what temperature do you set your AC and all of that? Then I begin to educate them. And so far, it has always been positive. The feedback has always been positive. But of course, you know, Nigeria, they want absolutely something free. So we move ahead. Now we're going to talk about electric motor. Now, motor drives a lot of things, okay? Surprisingly, your phones has motors in them. You know the vibrations that you feel from your phone. Those are motors that are producing those vibrations in your phone. So a lot of things, pumps are driven by motor, fans are driven by motor. There's so many things that are driven by motor. In fact, you can't talk about energy efficiency without talking about motor. Motor plays a major role, you know, in energy consumption, and it's a mechanical device. Okay, so we'll move. So 70% of commercial energy consumption is converted by electric motors. 70%. It's converted by electric, but think of it, your air conditioning system, your heat pump, all of those things are driven by motor. So it's very important. So motor efficiency plays a big role. Motor efficiency has improved a lot for smaller motors. The motor efficiency can be kept high by proper maintenance, but most problems are within the design of motor-driven applications and systems, not the motor itself, but the application that the motor is driving or the system that the motor is driving. Okay, we need to understand this. It's going to become a bit clear when I proceed further. So let's look at the life cycle cost of an electric motor. Okay, 3,000 operating hours per year for 7 years. Okay, 95% of the cost is on energy. Then maybe just about 3% is on investment. So if you're buying the motor at a certain amount of money, whatever it is that you're spending to acquire that motor, just about 3%. The main money you're going to spend is in running that motor, which is about 95%. And that's why it's very, very important to look at motors whenever you're conducting an energy audit. And you begin to look at the parameters. How is it operating? What are the things that can be done to make it more efficient and all of that? So potentials for saving energy in motor, okay? So even if you buy the most efficient motor in the market, you might not save a lot. You're going to save money, but you're going to save energy, but you're not going to save a lot, okay? You're going to save a lot by looking at the entire system. Remember when I said that a lot can be done when you look at the motor-driven applications. So about 60% of energy can be saved when you look at optimize all of those motor-driven applications, right from the connectivities, the belts that transfer the mechanical power from the motor to the applications and all of that. You need to look through all of this. So let us look at AC electric motor equations. So motor are electric powered. Now, if you look at the title, it's electric. We are talking about electric motor here. So the input here are electricity, okay? It can be measured in active power. It can be measured in apparent power. Active power is in kilowatts. Then apparent power is in kVA, okay? And we know the compatibility of between these two is a power factor that does the conversion here. So you have a power factor is equal to kilowatt all over kVA, right? So in that sense, the energy that is coming into that motor, if it's an active power, is given as an electrical energy. So kilowatt electrical is equals to root 3. Now I must make a correction. I think when I was making the presentation in the first class, I think I mentioned this as cube root or so. That was wrong. This is root 3, not cube root. This is root 3 times kilovolts. Sometimes you might be giving volts. Please look out for this. If you're giving in volts, you have to divide by 1,000, okay? Then times the current, then times the power factor. Now, if you take away the power factor, it becomes an apparent power, okay? So please take note of this. Now, the diagram you see up there is just illustrating that this is a three-phase motor and the input power can be in kilowatt or kVA. And the motor itself has its own losses. Then you see the horsepower output. That horsepower output is a mechanical power output, okay? And it's then powering a load. So how do you convert kilowatt electrical to kilowatt mechanical? That is the output of the motor, okay? There's a formula that does that for us. So kilowatt electrical is equal to kilowatt mechanical times load factor. Now you need to know the load factor of that motor. In the first class, I touched on load factor. If this motor can do 100% work, and you're only using it to do 20% work, then that's a lot of inefficiency. That's a lot of inefficiencies, okay? It is expected that your load factor should be up to 70, okay? Now, you have to now divide it by efficiency. When you look at the data sheet of motors, the nameplates that come with motors, you're going to see the efficiency of the motor. It should be stated there, okay? And those efficiencies that are stated there should be at full load. So when you see the efficiency, the assumption there, it is at full load, okay? So this is where you can get the efficiency of a particular motor. If you want to do this calculation for a particular motor, you look at the nameplate, some of this information would be there. And you're also going to see the kilowatt mechanical. What if they don't put mechanical, just know that it's the kilowatt mechanical, is the output of the motor, not the input. So if you now want, sometimes they can, you might see some starting question, they will give you the kilowatt mechanical, and they will not ask you to calculate the kilowatt electrical. That two different things. So this formula helps us to achieve all of that. So kilowatt E represents kilowatt electrical, and also kVA, which is the apparent power, are input to the motor. Now, kilowatt M, kilowatt mechanical, is the motor nameplate rating or output of the motor. I explained this earlier. So let's just do a little bit of formula rearrangement here. Let us make kilowatt mechanical the subject of the formula. So in this case, assuming we want to calculate, assuming that we are given the kilowatt electrical and we want to find out the kilowatt mechanical. So when you do some formula adjustment here, you're going to see that you have kilowatt mechanical. You have kilowatt mechanical times percentage of load. That's the load factor. It's either load factor or percentage load. They mean the same thing. Is equals to kilowatt electrical times efficiency. Okay, just cross multiplication gives us this. So now for a single phase motor, okay, kilowatt mechanical times percentage of the load is equal to, now let us open up that kilowatt electrical. Remember that kilowatt electrical is voltage times current times power factor. Okay, that we expanded then times efficiency. Now this is formula for single phase. And this is the formula for three phase. The only difference here, you're not introducing root three. And I said that root three is the same thing as if you punch root three on your calculator, you are going to get 1.73. It's the same thing. So when you see 1.73, it means the same thing as root three. So you don't get confused. So please note these formulas. We'll use them in the example that we are going to be solving. So right away, we have an example. So during my last energy audit, I saw a 75 kilowatt mechanical electric motor that had the following information on the nameplate: 400 volts, 131 amps, and is a three-phase motor, and the efficiency is 92.7, and it is at full load. What is the power factor of the motor? Okay, so in the solution, we are given the kilowatt mechanical, that is output. Kilowatt mechanical is output at 75 kilowatts. Voltage at 400, amperage at 131, efficiency at 92.7, and is a three-phase motor at full load, 100% load. We are not able to find the power factor. Okay, so if you look at this formula, you will not see power factor in that formula, right? So what do we do? But we know what the kilowatts we know what the kilowatt mechanical is. We know the load factor. We know the efficiency. So it makes common sense for us to use that to calculate the kilowatt electrical, right? So if you input the values that we know, that we already know, we know the kilowatt mechanical, we know the load factor, which is 100%, then it's one. Then we know the efficiency. If you put all of that, then you're going to get the kilowatt electrical as 80.9 kilowatts, okay? So secondly, using the kilowatt load from part A, now find the power factor of the motor at full load condition. Use the motor electrical equation, then solve for power. You know, of course, we know the formula for kilowatt electrical, which is root three times kilovolt times ampere times power factor. So we cannot find power factor. We cannot impute what we already know. We know what the kilowatt electrical is. We know what the voltage is. 400 divided by 1,000, they will know what the amp is. They can now make power factor subject of the formula. They can now calculate for power factor. And once we do that, this is what we're going to get. Okay, so we put what we already, we know the voltage, we know the amperage, we know the kilowatt electrical. When you do the computation, you're just going to get 89.1%. That's the power factor. If anyone has a question, please ask. I move ahead. So this is a sample question. Can the class make an attempt, please? It mustn't be correct, but make an attempt. And let me see your answers on the chat box, or you can on your mic and then say it out. So let's take 30 seconds. This is straightforward. Let's take 30 seconds to do that. Okay, Johnny said B. I need about two more answers to reveal the solution.
The answer is A.
Okay. What's your name, please? Please speak in.
Engineer Lawa. Engineer Lawa.
Oh, okay. Lawa says A. Okay. I need one more person to speak up or drop the message in chat. One more person, please. We have ladies here. I mean, please, I need to also hear your voice. I mean, in fact, I would rather prefer that ladies are the first to speak. Engineer Peter says A. Okay, so let me reveal what the solution is now. Okay, so here is the solution. It's just straightforward, okay? What do we know? We are given the amperage, we are given the voltage, and we are given the power factor, okay? So just put them in your electrical, what are they asking? We want to find the power that is drawn by the motor, right? So if you put that, it's just straightforward. You get 7.3 kilowatt. So kudos to Engineer Peter and Engineer Lawa. Thank you. So let's proceed. So this is another example. Can we make another attempt on this? This is not too different from what we had before, but let's make another attempt, please. I'll be so happy if a lady is the first to speak or first to post an answer. A three-phase induction motor is drawing 10 amperes at 400 volt. Let me move this. If the operating power factor of the motor is 0. Okay, Engineer Peter said C. If the operating power factor of the motor is 0.85 and the motor efficiency is 90%. Then the mechanical shaft power output of the motor is. Is this difficult? Okay, let me just. Okay, the rule says C. I mean, these are some of the easy questions that you should look at for when you want to write your exams. Now the whole essence of this is not just for you to write exam, but rather for you to also go to industries and then do this calculation and then perform an audit. Uche mentioned it yesterday that by next week we have an audit, a commercial audit to do in Lagos. So we'll be in Lagos next week for a commercial industrial audit rather, and perhaps we might keep it updated. See, okay. Let me review what the answer is now. Okay, so correct to all of you that said it. Okay, so let's proceed. Oh, so this is another sample question. I just included a lot of these sample questions so that you can just look at them. You can read the questions, try it on your own before you look at the solution. They're just pretty straightforward questions. Like I said, get the formulas, determine what you are given, and then determine what you're asked to find. Look for a formula that connects them together, and you input these values, and you have the answer. Please pay attention to the kind of motor. If it's three phase or a single phase, that's one. Two, look at the voltage. If you are given it in volt, you need to divide by 1,000 to convert to kilovolt. Please look out for this. Then your load factor. If you're not given any load factor, please assume full load. If the load factor is not given, always assume full load. Okay. So I think those are what I need to state for now. So these are just test questions. I didn't provide solutions for this. These are test questions that you can on your own solve. I'm going to share this updated slides with every one of you. So let's move ahead. So we're going to be talking about sleep and other behavior. Now, this is, we're still in motors, right? There's what's called sleep. Sleep is the percentage difference between the synchronous speed of a motor and the rotor speed. As the load is added to the motor, the shaft slows down a bit and the sleep increases. So what is synchronous speed? Forget about the big grammar, okay? When a motor is turning, okay, the speed at which that motor has been designed, I mean by design, the speed at which it has been designed to turn is what we call synchronous speed. Now, when you add a load to that motor, it slows down if that motor turns, maybe for example, if that motor turns like 10 times, maybe the load that you've added to it, to that motor through the rotor might just turn like about 9 times or 9 point something. So the difference between that design speed of the motor and the load that you've added to it and through the rotor and all of that is what we call this sleep. Okay. So that's why I say as the load is added to the motor, the shaft slows down a bit and the slip increases. Okay, so there's a formula to calculate the slip. So if there is a slip in motor, it is a sign of inefficiency. It induces inefficiency in a motor. So that's why we need to take care of the slip and make sure it's as minimal as possible. So motor slip can be calculated by the synchronous speed. That end that you're seeing is RPM, revolution per minute, is the speed minus the actual speed. That's when it's now loaded, divided by the synchronous speed, that is the design speed. That's just the formula, okay, to calculate the speed. So how do you determine the synchronous speed of the motor? How do you determine the synchronous speed of the motor? That is the design speed of this motor. So that's the next formula that you have there. And it is the frequency times 60. Now, we in Nigeria, we use 50 hertz as our frequency. In US, it is 60 hertz, okay? So most likely, the question you're going to be seeing will be 50 hertz. So 50 hertz times 60 divided by the number of pole pair. Sorry, this word came together, but it's number of pole pair, okay? So if you have four poles, now motors have poles, okay? If you have four poles, pole pair means that you're going to divide it by two. So you're going to pair every of the poles, right? And you're going to have two. If you have two poles, pole pair means one. Please note this, right? So this is just the formula for us to be able to do it. And the shaft that you're seeing there is just to relate how efficiency is increasing, and to the point you have the maximum efficiency and it begins to decrease as you begin to add load to the motor. As you begin to add load to the motor, the efficiency continues to increase until you get to about 100% and all of that. Then if you add more load to it, you're wasting your time. You're killing that motor. The efficiency begins to drop. So that's what that chart is now telling us, and it's now related to the power factor or efficiency and all of that. So let's quickly take a sample question, okay? For a four-pole induction motor operating at 50 hertz, the slip at a shaft speed of 1,450 RPM will be what? Can we attempt this question, or should I just go ahead? Based on the formulas I share, I think I will just go ahead because we don't have so much time. So remember the formula I shared. This is the same formula that I shared. We are given okay, what do we know about this question? It's a four-pole motor, so your pair will be two. That's one thing that we know. And it's operating at 50 hertz, okay? So that's another thing that we know. And the slip at the shaft speed is 1,450. So we need to calculate what is the synchronous speed, okay? for us to able to calculate the what are we even asked to do? Pay for Bumo, the sleep at this. Okay, the sleep. Fine, we are looking for the sleep. So we have to calculate the synchronous speed. And synchronous speed is the frequency, which is 50 times 60 divided by the number of four pairs. So it is four poles, and four pair is two, right? So when we do that, we're going to have 1,500 RPM. That's the synchronous, that's the design speed of that motor, okay? So the motor speed is what we know. We know it is 1,450. So the difference is 50, right? Is somebody asking a question? Otherwise, you mute your mic. Okay, so the difference is 50, right? So the 50 divided by the design speed will give us a motor slip of 3.33%. So that's how you calculate the slip of a motor. Okay, so there's a sample question. Okay, can we attempt this, please?
Oh, 50 times 55.
And are you saying something? Hello, Anna. So let me see who has gotten an answer, please. You can on your mic and speak. Otherwise, you can put that in the chat box. For a two-pole induction motor operating at 55 hertz, the slip at a shaft speed of 2,995 would be what? That 2,995 is the rotor speed. So you also need to calculate. Somebody
can
in.
Can we see the slide for the formula again?
Okay. Just a moment, please. So this are the formula.
Go back to the question.
Okay.
I'm getting 0.16.
0.16. We'll see to that. Does any other person have an answer? I need at least one or two so we can just proceed. Okay, let me just go ahead and then review what the solution is. So here we go. First of all, you need to determine the synchronous speed. Okay, we know this, we are given the frequency as 55, and we have two poles. So your pole pair is one. Okay, so when you do that computation, you're going to have 3,300 RPM, revolution per minute. Okay. So you now, based on that, you now cannot determine the motor slip. You know what the motor speed is. I mean, at a certain load, you know what that is. So when you now input all of that, you're going to get 9.2. That's going to be your motor slip. So let's go ahead. Efficiency and losses in motors. Of course, you know that what you're supplying to an electric motor is electricity, and what you're getting at is a mechanical energy, okay, or mechanical power rather. So in between the electricity that you're supplying and the mechanical power, you have losses. Somebody is having lunch. I think I should mute everybody. Okay, so in between the electricity that you supply to the mechanical output, you have losses. And what are these losses? You have iron losses, you have winding losses, you have rotor losses, you have friction and ventilation losses, you have load-dependent additional losses. We'll talk more about this. Okay, so new motor efficiency class. There is a internationally recognized classification, you know, for motors that determines their efficiency. So if you have an old industrial processes and you need to upgrade your equipment, it's good you look into this classification. When you look at the nameplate of this motor, you're going to see the different classes stated. So when you're out in the market to buy a new motor for an upgrade, it's better you look at the efficiency class. Now, if you look at this graph, okay, you're going to see that when the capacity of the motor is high, okay, you find out that the efficiency difference is not so much. But when you're dealing with a low capacity motor, that's where the efficiency comes a lot. Okay, so it's just an observation that you're going to see from this chart. Okay, so since June 2011, the International Electrotechnical Commission has some of these classifications. So the IE4 is a super premium efficiency, and that is the highest efficiency. Okay, following that one is a premium efficiency, not super. Then following that one is high efficiency. Then at the least among them is standard efficiency. So this is just a efficiency standard. So motor loading. Remember I told you that your load factor has a lot to do with energy consumption of the motor, right? Or the efficiency of the motor. So motor loading means how well the specified motor capacity and mechanical load are matched, okay? The motor has a capacity and the mechanical load, how are they matched, okay? So we'll look at different, there are three basic load situations. The first one is overload, okay? When you overload the motor, of course, efficiency begins to drop. You know, if you look at the chart I showed you the other time, I told you if you overload your motor, of course, what do you expect? The efficiency will begin to drop. It's a natural thing. Okay, so but not just efficiency, it begins to overheat, okay? It reduces lifespan of the motor and may fail regularly, okay? Now, it will lose energy in the form of heat, resulting in low efficiency. Now, if you underload the motor, what happens? Also a problem. It will run at a fraction of its specified power and draw excess and ineffective electrical currents. Okay? As this current does not supply useful energy, efficiency is low. Utilities may demand penalty for this excessive and inefficient current. This doesn't apply in Nigeria anyway. If it's in a foreign abroad, yeah, you can be penalized, either for a poor power factor or if you exceeds your demand limit, your maximum demand limit. You can also pay for that. So nominal load.
Can you please explain the underload again? How does it draw excessive current?
When your generator, your diesel generator. If you're running your diesel generator at 20% load factor, you don't expect that diesel generator to be drawing fuel that is going to use to produce 20 kilowatts. It can be drawing diesel that is can use to produce 30 kilowatts, but you're taking only 20. So this has been designed to perform at a minimum level. And you're now setting it below that even minimum level. Okay? I don't know if this scenario makes any helps understand it better.
I'm a bit confused.
Leo, let me come in at this point.
Okay.
What I understand that if you underload means you will be running at loss because the energy you're supposed to use to produce something that will take you like 20 tons or 30 tons, you use it to produce only 5 tons, whereby you are consuming electricity and machine is running other things. So that means it's not good to be run in other load. So you want to run it at least 75% of the load, not under load, it's not the best. You run at loss.
Yeah, my understanding is if you have the load, is the load that will determine the amount of current that will be drawn. I don't know. I'm just asking. I'm not electrically biased.
Yeah, but the time factors. Mm-hmm. If you put time factors into everything you are doing also. For instance, the time you will use to produce something of 10 tons, you will produce only 5 tons. Even though you are drawing little current, but you are losing time.
Okay.
All your
inputs are valid, but let me make this point. If you have a motor of 50 kilowatts, okay, a motor of 50 kilowatts, and then you're using it to power a load of 10 kilowatts. 10 kilowatts is even more. Let me say you're using to power a load of 2 kilowatts, okay?
Yeah.
And then you have another motor of 3 kilowatts. And you're using it to power a load of 2 kilowatts. Which one will draw more current?
Did I really follow?
You have a motor of that can do 50 kilowatt load output.
Yes.
50. But you're using it to do only two out of the 50. Okay. And then you have another motor that is rated 3 kilowatts. And you're using it to do a load of 2 kilowatts.
Is the one of the 50 kilowatt with drum on current?
Exactly. Why? Because you have underloaded it.
So, I think I'm messing it up. So, is actually the motor that will be drawing the current,
yes.
Not the load?
Not the load, but the motor, the load, the current that the motor is going to draw is dependent on how you load it.
Exactly.
No, but since you have a small load,
the motor will still run at the normal current, even though the load or not.
Okay, it's clearer now.
You understand? Okay. When you put load, that is where you will increase a little, but the normal load of 50 kilowatts is more higher than one of that 3 kilowatts.
Okay.
Now there's a minimum loading that motor has been designed to operate.
If you load it
below that minimum loading, it's still going to draw the current it's going to use for that minimum load.
Yes.
Okay. I get it now.
Understand.
Thank you.
Okay, good. So now we are talking about the nominal load. Now the nominal load is whereby you've done a good job. You have a certain motor capacity. And you load it optimally, maybe 70 or 80 or 90%. Fine, good. Okay, so in that case, you're very good to go. Okay, so these are the three basic loads in motor. So the nominal loading is the preferred load situation. Okay, so underloading is a very common practice, causing suboptimal motor efficiency. It results in low efficiency, lower power factor, and then high cost of the motor and related equipment. There's a chart that just tried to relate the, I think this efficiency as a function of a load factor. So it's trying to relate efficiency and load factor. I mean, the more you load your motor, of course, the more efficiency increase and all of that. I think it's just for different capacities of motor. You try to draw the chart for different capacities of motor.
The cost here is operational cost, right?
Which cost are you talking about?
The
on
higher cost for the motor.
Yes.
Okay.
It's on operational cost, yeah. So reasons for underloading include the following: usage of large safety factor in equipment. Okay, this is very common. Underloading is very common in most things that we do. Even our generators, we oversize our generators and we underload it. Okay, underutilization of equipment, selection of larger motor to maintain output level. Okay, large motor where high starting torque is required. I mean, these are all part of the reasons why a lot of us underload motors. Now I'm saying a lot of us because sometimes knowingly or unknowingly, I might also have, you know, just remember I said that motor powers a lot of things, not just in industry, in the home and all of that. If you buy a very big fridge and you're just, whereas you just require a very small fridge, okay, you're underloading the motor in that fridge. Okay, that's why I say, so knowingly or unknowingly, I could also be part of it. But for the fact that I'm now aware, and every one of us is also becoming aware, we have to look out for all of this situation and all of that. It's very common with generators in Nigeria. So effects of voltage variations in motor. Yes, the other day, somebody asked a question of voltage, percentage, the tolerance level for voltage imbalance and stuff like that. I have one of the slides for that. So voltage drop causes change in motor efficiency, power factor, running current, and temperature. If motor terminal voltage is below the rated voltage, it will draw more current than the rated current, which will ultimately result in the overheating of the motor, windings, and thus reduces the life of the motor. Now, if the voltage is below the rated voltage, it's just going to draw excess current to compensate for it. It's just electrical phenomenon. So voltage imbalance. Now, based on the question that one of you asked, so here it is. 1% is okay for voltage imbalance. 1% is okay. Beyond 1% causes current imbalance, okay? And thus loses heat. So the graph you're seeing here is just a percentage of voltage imbalance then against the rating power factor. Not power factor, just a factor that tells you how the losses that you're going to be having when you begin to have a higher level of unbalanced load. So, and what is beyond motor? Remember at first that I said that efficiency is beyond the motor itself. More of the efficient measures can be implemented at the motor-driven applications. Okay, so the mechanical application that motor is driving, you can achieve a lot as well. So from the overall savings, you can look at the total system. So at the total systems, assuming the motor is powering a pump, then you're looking at the pipe dimensions, you're looking at the armatures and the valves, you're looking at storage, you're looking at operating hours, you're looking at power system. Now this is holistically, you're just looking beyond the motor, okay? But again, you know, between the motor and the mechanical transmission system, you have the gearbox and you have the belt, the drive belt and all of that. So you can also save energy looking at those aspects. So you have variable speed drive, you have the gearbox, you have the pumps, you have the belts. You know, all of these places present an opportunity to save energy. We'll explain more of them in the coming slide. Then on the motor itself, you just have to make sure that you are able to balance the load. You know, there is no so much you can do on the motor. Rather, just balance the load and make sure you have a higher class of IE. That's the most you can do on the motor. So if you look at the level of savings that you can achieve, you see that you can just achieve a little amount of saving on the motor, and then medium on the drive change, and then there is a lot you can achieve looking at everything holistically, the driven applications. That's what this is talking about. The percentage savings possible. You can read this one up, I mean. Low and high cost measures. You can read up this. Let's just So let us look at drives this time around. So drives are used to transfer mechanical energy. Remember that the motor collects electrical energy and it gives out mechanical energy. And you have to transfer that mechanical energy to the things that you want to use it for. So the things, whether it's a conveyor that you want to drive or whatever it is that you want to drive, you have to transfer that mechanical energy from the motor to that device or the system. So that's where drives comes in. So you have different kinds of drives. You have a direct drive, which is usually the best way, okay? Then you have a belt drive, then you have the gear drive. Okay, so these are just different kinds of drive. So here are measures of that you can implement to save energy in the drive system. Now, the whole essence
hello,
of the
hello,
drive
sir. System, I have okay. a question for you.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Are you converting electrical energy to mechanical or mechanical to a mechanical? I didn't get you right there. Because an electric motor to a drive, I think you are converting the electrical to mechanical drive energy.
The motor itself.
Yeah, it's electrical.
The motor itself is different from the drive that we are talking about.
Yeah, I know.
So the motor convert electrical to mechanical.
Uh-huh, but you were saying mechanical to electrical. That's why I come in. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. If that's what I said, sorry. Thank you for pointing that out. Okay. So the motor convert electrical to mechanical. Okay. Now the drive transfers that mechanical to another mechanical. Okay, now the reason why we look at the drive is to make sure that look, there are no losses. If the motor rotor is turning, if it turns like maybe 10 times and the drive is turning like 2 times, then there might be losses. So you have to make sure that there are no lapses, you know, from the mechanical output from the motor. Make sure that as much of the mechanical energy that's coming out from that motor is transferred to the driven application. And the best way to do that is using a direct drive. If you use a direct drive, you transfer 100% of the rotational energy that is coming out from that motor to the driven application. So with that, we move ahead to the next one, which is pump. So I have just a test question here. Are pump the same as motor? Please unmute yourself and then speak. I need one or two persons to respond to this.
Yes, yes.
Pumps are the same thing as motor.
Yes.
Okay. Does anybody have a contrary view about this? Okay. So let me just proceed. Unfortunately, it is not. Pumps are not the same thing as motor. Pump is a motor-driven application. Motor drives pump. Okay, so they're not the same thing. Your pumping machine or your sumo has motor components and it has a pump. Okay, so we're going to look, so now we are going to look at pump. That's why we say that motor drives a lot of things. Your ceiling fan, your standing fan are driven by motor. Okay, so let us look at centrifugal pumps, which are the most common types of pump that you see. So let us look at how the pump operates. Now the pump have what we call impeller. Impeller is more like the blade that generates that torque, that pressure that pushes the water or the water because we're talking about pump here, okay? So then you have what we call impeller diameter. I think let me just go ahead to the next one. Okay. So pumping system uses approximately 12% of the global energy consumption. The lifetime of a pump is between 15 to 50 years, and saving potentials can be as much as 50%. We'll look at that subsequently. Then what is the demand? Pumping demand is defined by static head. The height that you're pumping, that is the static head, okay? Not only that, it's also defined by the dynamic head, the flow speed and the frictional losses along the pipe and the valves and the bends and the pipe diameter. If you have a very small pipe diameter, it also restricts the pump, and it also acts as a load to the pump. So these are the two things that we define as a load to the pump or the demand to the pump. So we have a pump equation. Pump equation is proportional to the product of the head. Now the head is the height in meters, and the flow rate, the quantity of water that is coming out at the point where you want it, represented by Q, divided by the pump efficiency. So this is the equation. Just note this equation. Then where Q is the liters per minute and H is the height in meters, P would be the kilowatt, that is the energy input to the pump. Now this P that you're seeing, kilowatt, is the energy output from the shaft of the motor. Not kilowatt electrical, it's kilowatt mechanical from the motor. So important saving can be obtained by lowering the flow rate. Of course, if you lower the flow rate, of course, you extend the time that you need to achieve certain quantity of flow. Okay. Reduce the head. You can reduce the height. Let us just some example. Okay, I gave this formula. So rate of with a flow rate. Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
I need to confirm. Okay. Sorry, I don't know the point that. Can you still see my screen?
No.
Okay.
Let me share your screen.
Huh?
It's coming up. It's coming. It's there now.
Okay.
You can see it here.
To page one, it's back to the first slide.
Yeah, but I just need to go to.
Yes, we can see it now.
Okay, so this is where I was, where I had an example. What is the load of a pump with a flow rate of 9,000 liters per minute with a head pressure of 410 liters? Pump efficiency is 3. Can we just make an attempt? Just push. This is a question.
Sorry, where is this noise coming from?
Let me mute everyone. Sorry, I don't know where that is coming from, but I'll just mute everyone now. So if you use the flow equation that I gave earlier, which I repeated here, all you need to do is to put your Q, I think it was given, your flow rate is 9,000 liters per minute, your H, which is the height, is given as 110, and your efficiency is also given, it's straightforward. Then you get your kilowatt P as 195 kilowatts. Now, bear in mind that this is the shaft power required to operate the pump. Not electrical power. Okay. So please note that we move. Okay. So I'm going to discuss affinity laws here now. Affinity laws applies to pumps, how they operate. There are things you need to know in a pump that affect its operation. If you understand the things that affect the operation of a pump, then affinity loss is nothing so serious, okay? So there are things that affect the performance of a pump. One of them is the impeller diameter. So this is an impeller. This stuff here is an impeller. It's the thing that rotates that actually pushes the water, okay? So the diameter from this center to the, in fact, not just from the center, from this end to this end matter. That is the diameter of the impeller, okay? So it affects the flow. If you have a higher impeller, you're going to have a higher flow. Okay, if you have a shorter impeller, you're going to have a shorter flow. So impeller diameter is one. The rotational speed of the impeller, that is the revolution per minute of this impeller, is another. If it's moving so faster, if it's moving faster, then you're going to have a higher flow. If it's moving slow, then you're going to have a lower flow. Okay. Then the power input, the shaft power input to the motor is another factor. Okay. So impeller diameter, the rotational speed of the impeller, then the power. Okay, then the height that you're pumping to. If you're pumping to a lower height, you're going to need a lower energy. You're going to need a lower power to be able to achieve that. So the height is also another factor. So what affinity laws does is that it helps us to relate all of these factors together. So we can easily calculate them. That's what affinity laws does. It helps us to relate all of these things we are talking about. So we can calculate whatever it is that we want to calculate. So let us look at the first set of the laws. Now, effect of rotational speed. Remember, I talked about the impeller speed. So let us look at how the impeller speed affects the power consumption of the motor, the height of the water pumping, and also the volume of water that you're going to get. So effect of rotational speed, keeping the impeller diameter constant. So you're keeping the impeller diameter constant, but you want to know how is the rotational speed going to affect the power consumption. How is it going to affect the flow height? How is it going to affect the volume of water that you're going to get? So the first law is this, that the flow rate is directly proportional to the rotational speed of the impeller. Remember, we're keeping the impeller diameter constant. We're only varying the rotational speed. So the flow rate is directly proportional to the rotational speed of that impeller. So if you increase the impeller speed, okay, automatically you increase your flow rate. That's just straightforward, okay? Then let us look at how that rotational speed relates with the head, the height, okay? So the height of the pump, of the static head, okay, is proportional to the square of the rotational speed. The height is proportional to the square of the rotational speed. Then the power consumption of that motor is proportional to the cube of the rotational speed. This is the first set of laws. Now, let us vary this a little bit. Let us keep the impeller diameter constant and then vary that rotational speed. Okay, so if we do that, we have the similar equation that we have at first. So the volume of flow is proportional to the impeller diameter. So if you have a higher impeller diameter, you of course have a higher water output. Okay, so now the height that you're pumping the water is proportional to the square of the impeller diameter. And the third one is that the power consumption of that motor is proportional to the cube of the impeller diameter. So all those are just what we know as the affinity laws. So what this helps us to do is that when you change any one of them from level one to level two, how does this affect every other one? Okay, so you have flow rate number one, and then you change the rotational speed from level one to level two. What will be your flow rate number two? Okay, it's just, that's what this formula is all about. So Q here is flow rate, the N is rotational speed, the D is impeller diameter, the H is the height or the head, they're all the same thing, and the P is the power consumption. So when you put these two laws together, this, remember I separated them, the first set where you keep the rotational speed constant, and then you, where you vary the rotational speed and then keep the diameter, impeller diameter constant, and the second set where you now change the impeller diameter and then keep the rotational speed constant. So if you now combine these two, the first equation in the first set, if you match the first equation in the first set and then the first equation in the second set, you will have the first equation in this general set. the first equation in the first set, the first equation in the second set, if you match both of them, you have the equation in the general set. The same thing applies to the second one. If you match the first equation and in the first set, if you match this equation and this other equation, you have this third equation. The same thing applies to the the equation that has to do with power, impeller diameter, and the rotational speed. So all of these are just an equation. Let us see how we can apply them in solving problems in the power system. In the pumping system. So here's an example. A centrifugal pump is delivering 200 meter cube per hour. The impeller diameter is trimmed by 10%. The new flow, that is in meter cube per hour, will be what? Okay. So what do we know? We know the Q1, that is the flow rate of one, which is 200. Now, they say that the impeller diameter is trimmed by 10, so it's reduced by 10%. You can choose whatever impeller diameter that you want. You can choose 1,000, but as much as your number two, that your D2 will be 10% less of your D1. So for ease of simplicity, I've decided to choose 100. So my D2 is now 10% less of 100. If whatever you like, choose, as long as your D2 is 10% less of it, we are going to get the same answer. So what we are now being asked is that we have to find the Q2, that is, when you move the, when you change the impeller diameter from 100 to 90, what flow are you going to get? You were getting 200 before, but if you change it from that 100 to 90, what flow are you going to get? So we have to look for the formula that relates flow and impeller diameter. Okay? So if we go back to our formulas, you see that on the second set, you have flow and impeller diameter. So we just take Q1 over Q2 is equal to D1 over D2. And we just put it, and then we put in the values that we know. Once we do that, we have Q2, which is 180 meter cube per hour. Okay? So what that simply means is that if you reduce the impeller diameter by 10%, keeping the rotational speed constant, flow will be reduced from 200 meter cube per hour to 180 meter cube per hour. That's what it means. Okay? So there is a second question. Can we make an attempt to this? If you want me to show you the formulas again, please let me know. I think we are really short of time. Maybe I should just continue. Or do you want to try this out? Let me know what you think. Nobody is saying anything.
Please, let's continue.
Okay. For want of time, right? Okay, so here is the solution here, okay? What do we know? We know the rotational speed, which was given to us. A centrifugal pump is operating at 1,140 RPM. That is the rotational speed of this pump. We know the N1. If the power is to be reduced by 75%. Now, if you see this kind of question, just choose any initial value that you want. So for simplicity, I have also choose 100. But you reduce, EFOR is reduced to, not by, EFOR is reduced to 75%. So you reduce that 100 to 75%, right? So that your power number two. Your power number one is 100. Your power number two is 75%. So the exit, the speed of the pump as per affinity law will now become what? So we look at our formula and see what the formula that relates power and rotational speed. So if we go back to our formula, we are looking for power and rotational speed. So it's in the first set. So you see P1 over P2 is equal to N1 cube over N2 cube. So let's go back. So we have P1 over P2 is equal to N1 cube over N2 cube. When you put in your known values, 100 over 75 is equal to 1,440 cube RPM divided by N2 cube. The answer you're going to get for your N2, that is your rotational speed, when you reduce that power from 100 kilowatts to 75 kilowatts, you're going to gets a rotational speed of 1,308 revolutions per minute. Before it was 1,440, you reduce the power input. How does it affect your the rotation of your impeller? How does it affect the rotation of your rotational speed of your impeller? It will reduce it to 1,308 RPM. So that means that if you reduce the shaft power by 25%, keeping the impeller diameter constant, rotational speed will be reduced from 1,400 to 1,308 RPM. So this is very, very useful when you're doing calculations in pumping systems, you know, to determine the level of its efficiency and all of that. So oversized pump, sometimes we also oversize pump, and it causes a lot of problems. So oversized pump result in higher pumping system electricity cost and requires more frequent maintenance than properly sized pumps. So what are the indicators that this pump has been oversized? Excess flow noise, okay, frequent replacement of bearing and seals, the intensive use of flow control options. So you have a flow, and then you're not reducing the speed. You now have a valve to reduce the speed, okay? It's an indication that pump has been oversized, okay? It's better you look for a pump that can give you the right amount of flow that you require, the amount of pressure that you require, rather than having a pump and then you're not using a valve to reduce the speed. So how do you operate a pump? There's what's called best efficiency pump. Just like motors. Motors have their best performance points, okay, where you have the highest efficiency. The same thing happens to pumps. But in the case of a pump, we call it best efficiency point, okay? So if you look at the graph, I think most manufacturers will provide this graph for you, you know, of pumping systems. So you look at the efficiency, look at the highest point, the peak of that efficiency, you trace it down to the point where, I mean, okay, so this is the highest point of the efficiency. This line now is the efficiency line, okay? Now, on the horizontal axis, you have the capacity, okay? That's the quantity of flow that you can achieve from that motor, okay? So if you look at the peak of your efficiency and you trace it down to your head, this green one is your head, okay? That is the height that you can pump to, okay? So you can now see that as the height drops, your flow rate increases. So your flow rate increases as this height drops, right? So you not trace down from your peak efficiency at the point where it meets your height, this is your head. That becomes your best efficiency point. So what this means is like, you can achieve this amount of flow, I mean, on the horizontal axis, at this certain height. This height here, the 60 here, is your maximum, is your best height that you can position that pump to pump at, okay? And at that point, it's going to be delivering the volume that you see on the horizontal axis here, okay? So there's another thing that you need to look out for. There's a brake horsepower. So at that best efficiency point, the power consumption of that motor is what we know as the brake horsepower. At the point it crosses this brake horsepower will be the power consumption. If you trace it to the right, you will see the horsepower of that motor. I mean, the rating of the motor that you need to be able to achieve that. So this is the best efficiency point. How to determine the best efficiency point of your motor. If you do lower than the best efficiency point, you create a problem. It becomes inefficient. If you do higher than the best efficiency point, it's also a problem and it creates inefficiency. So here is what happened. In this case now, we've been able to determine the best efficiency points to be here. So if you do less than the best efficiency point, what's going to happen is that you're going to have rise in temperature, you're going to have a lower efficiency, you're going to have noise, you're going to have vibrations. And we have all of this, the motor can easily break down. But if you increase it beyond the best efficiency point, you're going to increase the power consumption, you're going to lower the efficiency as well, you're going to have noise, you're also going to have vibration. So it's best to operate every motor at their best efficiency point. So when you go out to audit and you see It's best, I keep saying motor instead of pump. Please pardon me. So it is best to operate pumps at their best efficiency points, right? When you go out in the field to audit pumping system, it's always good that you request for the design data for you to be able to determine their best efficiency point. And then you can now begin to take measures to see their real, I mean, the real capacity of those motors, if they are underperforming or overperforming. In the case, I mean, in this case, they are performing beyond their best efficiency point. Okay. So it's good we look at all of that. We'll go out to do audits. Then how do you connect motors? How do you connect pump in series and in parallel? Okay. If you connect pump in series, if you connect one pump and you connect the next one to it in series, you're not going to increase the flow rate. Okay. But you can increase the height. You can increase the flow height. So if you're pumping from level one to level 10, you can use one pump to push it from level one to level five, and you use another pump to push it from level five to level 10. In that way, you're not going to increase the flow rate at level 10. But of course, what you have done, you have, because you have two pumps, you cannot increase your height, your the height of your pumping. That's what series connection does for you. Then you have parallel connections. If you do parallel connection, you're not going to increase your flow rate. If you do parallel connection, that is when you're going to increase your flow rate. You're not going to increase your height, okay? If you have two pumps pumping water into the same container at the same time, you have more volume of flow into that container, but you're not going to increase the height of that operation. So that's what a parallel operation of a pump is. Simple categorization of motor. This is how motor has improved over time. You can read up this. Pumps approach of the, now these are optimization procedures of pumping system. I talked about reducing pressure, and what that means is throttling. I'm looking for that here. So use high efficient pump for base load. Throttle control and bypass control reduces output. I talked about reducing pressure. So you have a pump and it's generating high pressure of water, but you don't want that high pressure. You have to use throttle or valve to reduce the pressure. It's all this leads to inefficiency. So you have to look out for those things and then eliminate them. Then of course you can use VSD, variable speed drive or variable frequency drive, okay, to reduce the speed of that.
Yeah, all right.
Do you have a question or you just make it a comment?
Yeah, I wanted to make a comment about the reducing of the pressure because exactly. Frequency drive can do that. Exactly. You've already said, you said it now, so there's no issue.
Exactly. So
thank you.
You can use VSD. Yeah, you can use VSD to do that and all of that. So you can read this up and it's just clear on your own. So this is variable frequency drive. What are the advantages of variable frequency drive for motor systems? And so motor-driven systems are often designed to handle peak load that have a safety factor. Sometimes we oversize these safety factors and they are underperforming. So this often leads to energy inefficiency in systems that operate for extended period at reduced load. The ability to adjust motor speed enables closer matching of the motor output to the load. You know, this is where you talk about the nominal loading of the motor and all of that. So when you use VSD, you can actually reduce, correctly size that motor system or the pumping system to the load that you're trying to power with it. So hence, adding a variable frequency drive to a motor-driven system can offer potential energy saving in a system in which the load varies with time. Energy is saved by reducing motor speed according to load. Best result provide control loop with sensor. Okay, so what this is trying to say is, this is synonymous to inverter AC systems, okay? Inverter AC system has variable speed drive in them, which actually controls the compressor when a certain temperature is reached. So what this is saying, you might have a sensor that determines the level of load that you need, whether a pumping system or a motor system. So once the optimal loading is required, it's now communicates to the variable speed drive, and the variable speed drive now automatically lowers or increases the power that goes to that motor, okay? So this is more like an automation, and that's why you're seeing something like sensors and control, you know, to automatically match the motor load or the pumping load to the actual load that is being powered. So VSD is best suitable for drive systems with low static head, optimized control range. Okay, optimized control range from 30 to 75% of the load. Now, VSD are best suited for, if you have a large motor that are often operated at a high load factor, you might not really need the variable speed drive. But if you have a motor that almost all the time the load on it is varying, then that's where it becomes more profitable to install a VSD.
So a quick question.
Okay.
Question. For if you are trying to do like an energy audit, is it possible you can do a retrofit using a VSD? So maybe you have a motor running and it doesn't have a VSD and it typically operates at very low load factor.
Yes. Yes, you can do that.
Okay.
That's the essence of VSD. Yes. Okay. So you have other advantages of VSD here. You have electric advantage. It reduces the startup current, effective and detailed motor protection, reduction of reactive load. Then you have the mechanical advantage, brake and acceleration control of rotating masses, demand control production. I mean, you can use a particular size of motor to power different loads. Okay, as much as you can always use the VSD to regulate it. So optimizing work conditions for pumps and vents. So let's move to HVACs. This time, just the HVAC components. I know we've talked about HVAC, but this time just the components. So we have the types of different types of ventilators. These are just pictures. Most of these things are just pictures, just to let you understand what air handling. This is an air handling unit in a basement. Now, air handling unit for some buildings, they have a central air handling unit or central cooling system, not the individual cooling system. Okay, so this is one of the systems. I'm just trying to rush through this. You can read some of this and then you understand. If you have questions, you can always ask. So there are two ways to operate a air handling system. There's a constant air volume system. In a constant air volume system, you have a central air handling system. Now, air handling system collects air from the atmospheric environment. It conditions that air and then pushes it through a duct to the various departments or various rooms in the building, okay? So for constant air volume, there is no control. There's nothing like maybe VSD. It's just on, it's condition the air and push it to different rooms. If all the rooms turns off their vents, you know, in the rooms you have a vent where you now have the air outlet to flow into the room. If all the rooms turn off those vents, the air handling unit does not have any way of knowing that it has been turned on. It will just keep pushing the air. So it's constant volume. It doesn't regulate itself, okay? So that's what constant air volume is. Then you have a better one, which is a variable air volume, okay? Variable air volume has a way of knowing if all the rooms has turned off their vents. It has a way of knowing the level of air, quantity of air that it needs to produce to throw into the building. So it has a sensor that feeds back to the motor that powers the fan that pushes the air. So that's why it's called variable air volume system, okay? So it uses VSD to do this regulation, okay? So like I said, these air handling units are central. Some of them are on top of the roof, some of them are at the basement. They collect atmospheric air, they condition it, they push it into the different parts of the building. So now compression cooling, this is like the air conditioning processes, okay? So let me see. So I'm just gonna talk about the refrigeration cycle. We have the evaporator, which is what you have inside your house. that collects cold air and then pushes it into your room and all of that. You have a compressor, which is a component inside the condenser that is outside your house. Okay, let me just read straight from what I have here. Even though when you read, perhaps you understand. Liquid refrigerants evaporate at low pressure and low temperature. The heat necessary for evaporation is being removed from the medium to the cold. Either air or water. You know, you can use air. For air conditioning system, it is air that is being passed through the evaporator to absorb coldness from the refrigerant, and it throws it into the room. Okay. So when that refrigerant gets outside, compressor compresses that gas to a very high temperature, approximately from 60 to 120 degrees centigrade, and it pushes it through the condenser system. Now the condenser, for the fact that refrigerant is very hot, the condenser blows air across it and then reduces the temperature, maybe from that 60 to 120 down to about 40 or whatever. Then it goes through an expansion valve. When you pass it through an expansion valve, the temperature drops. In fact, it drops significantly to about maybe 0 or 8. And it is that very cold temperature that eventually comes back into the evaporator. So it's a cycle. This is the cycle from 1 to 7, okay? So waste heat recovery. Now this is the same cycle for air conditioning system. So if you look, you have the condenser here, which is the outside. You have the cooling evaporator here, which is the cooling. You have the expansion valve. Then you have the compressor. The only thing different is that you've added a heat exchanger. You know, when the compressor compresses that gas, it becomes very hot, okay? So assuming you have an application where you want to use that hot, that heat, to maybe to dry something or to do any industrial process, then you just attach a heat exchanger here, and then you harness that heat and then use it for your industrial application, okay? So what that means is that the heat that you're pushing out from the room, you're actually using it to perform your industrial operation. So it's a way to say, instead of burning, maybe burning gas to, using boiler to generate steam to do your dry process, you can actually collect this heat from your compressor system and then send it to your processes, and then you can use it, and then you save that energy. The whole idea here is heat movement. How do you move heat? You're moving heat from your indoor space and you're training that into the environment. What if there is need for that heat? There are places where you need to use them, okay? Which is, these are the things that causes climate change and global warming and all of that. But if you're able to harness that heat and use it to generate hot water for your own house, then it makes a lot of sense. Why would you throw the heat out and then you can use your electricity to generate water that you want to use and bath, okay? To have your bed anyway. Whereas you can just install heat exchanger and then collect the heat. In doing all of this, this is where you have to do economic analysis, cost-benefit analysis, which was which I talked yesterday. Some of them, when you do a cost-benefit analysis, it might not be viable. So that's the drawdown of some of them. Unless you have a very large quantity of heat and you also have a high need for that heat, that's when it might begin to make economic sense to invest such money in those heat exchangers. So motors in HVAC system, motors drive a lot of things in HVAC system. Remember I told that motor is different from fan, is different from pump. All of these are motor-driven applications. Chillers, pump, fan, damper control valve, all of these are motor-driven applications. So you have a lot of motor in this in your HVAC systems. So efficiency control in ventilators. So now this is actually your motor here. Then you have your belt that transfer the mechanical power energy or mechanical power or the mechanical power to the now this is a ventilator, okay? It transferred it to the ventilator itself that has an impeller. So here is an impeller, okay? It's inside the ventilator, so you can't see that. So there's an impeller inside this ventilator, but in this case, instead of water, instead of fluid, it is pushing out air, okay? So this volume flow and pressure, it could be, now this is air. If you're using it to do what, to drive a pump, then it will become water, okay? But in this case, it's for air conditioning, or yeah, for air handling unit. So it's pushing out air. So in all of this, it presents an opportunity to save energy. You can see that you can introduce VSD to this motor. You can introduce VSD to this motor so that it controls the volume of air that you need. If you don't need so much air, you reduce the speed of this motor. It reduces also the air that is being thrown out. The same thing happens here. So fan efficiency and control. You can read all of this off and then key optimization approaches. You can read all of this. They will have combined heat and power, okay? Remember I said that in your generator, okay, let me use this generator as an example, your diesel generator. You're generating electricity from you're converting chemical energy in the form of diesel and you're producing electricity. But the diesel that you put inside there contains 100% energy, 100% energy. By the time you're getting electricity as a form of energy, you're having like maybe 30% of it. So you've lost like 70. How did you lose those 70? In most cases, you're losing them as a form of heat, okay? So if you have the need for heat in your house, is it possible for you to attach a heat exchanger and then collect those heat from your generator and then send it into your house? Maybe for better. Now, this is, I'm using household as an example, but think of this in an industrial process where you have a large gas power plant, okay? And you're losing a large amount of heat. You can collect those heat and then use it, send it into the industry and use it to power and they use it to provide heating load for your industrial processes. So that concept is what combined heat and power means. In some cases, you can also have three kind of power. So you can also use that heat to generate cooling, okay? In that case, it's absorption process. It's different from compression cooling. It's absorption cooling. Okay, it's written here. Use of absorption coolers. In this case, you're using heat to generate cooling. That's what absorption coolers here means. So in some cases, you can use the same source of fuel. You can use the same source of fuel to generate electricity, generate heat, and also generate cooling. So in that case, you have three generation. So optimization processes to have in mind. You can just read it. They have compressed air system. Compressed air systems are used in industry to power some certain pneumatic tools. Tools that uses pressure to operate. So if you, in some industries, they just generate this compressed air centrally and then they distribute it just the same way you distribute your steam, you know, across the industrial facilities, okay? You can have that same thing in compressed air system. Now, compressed air is very expensive. So compressed air, and this is very, very expensive. Just like motors, the operational cost of that is like 73%, okay? It only costs you about 18% as a capital cost, but 73% in the life cycle of that compression system goes in powering that compressors. So there's a high opportunity to save. A lot of people will just use the hose, they will open it to blow out some certain dust and all of that. It's very expensive, you don't just waste compressed air to go out dust or clean some certain unnecessary equipment. It's a lot of waste. So this is a sample industrial layout of a compressed air system. So what you have here, you have an energy input, but you have a lot of waste. In the process of compressing that air, you have a lot of waste. In the end, what you have that you can use to power your pneumatic tools are tools that you can power with air pressure. So the output that you actually have to power your pneumatic tools is just about, okay, so you started with 5,280 kilowatt hour, but actually what you actually use for that is 415. So you've lost a lot of energy that didn't add any productive or any value to your system. So it is very important to look at all of this. There are several energy efficiency measures to implement. And here are some of them. You can actually read all of this and then look out for leaks. If there are leaks, locate them and then fix them. So these are just energy efficiency measures. Now, let me quickly state this. If you're compressing air, it is better to locate areas that are cool. If you compress a cool air, you're going to get a higher volume of air and you're going to reduce some of the heat losses. in the process. So that's what this chart here is just trying to talk about. Actually, this number, that this 02468 should have been minus. So as you're going down, you know, to a cooler temperature, you're increasing the output, the compressor output. So you need a cooler air. You know, if your air intake is cool, is cold, then you have an increased compressor output. Remember that if you compress air, you're going to increase the temperature. And once you increase the temperature, you increase the losses. So the idea is that look for a region where I can get a cold air and then compress it so that when the temperature increases, it doesn't increase so much that you're not beginning to have so much losses. So that's just the basic idea. So you can just read off this checklist and all that. Okay, so thank you very much. Finally, we've come to the end of this presentation. And I thank you so much for your active participation. Engineer Ushe.
Okay.
Thank you very much for coordinating this. If there are questions, comments, contributions, please go ahead and then do that.
Okay, Chima, thank you so much. Please, as we all know, this is the median edition of this training, and we are looking forward.
Uche, can I stop the recording now?
Yeah, definitely. Stop the recording, please.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.